evening, welcome to a new season of the All About Auckland show. I'm Kane Glass. This week we're on Tararua Road, one of the busiest roads in the southeast. Auckland Transport have just announced that they're bringing forward by 12 years plans to build a busway from Pakuranga to Botany. So magic can happen in Auckland Transport. Tonight we talk with local body activist Penny Bright. We look at the council split following Auckland Transport's announcement that they're considering light rail. Then we go to the Unitary Plans hearings panel where they're considering residential and commercial development on our best rural soils. Local body activist Penny Bright has seen mayors come and mayors go. However, her career as an Auckland Council watchdog has continued unabated. Recently, she's been campaigning in Wellington, warning councils there about the dangers of amalgamation. I caught up with Penny last week and asked her what the messages were that she was going to give to the Wellington councillors.
What I'm seeking to get implemented and enforced is the rule of law, which currently exists under the Local Government Act in terms of the purpose of local government. And the essence of that is cost-effective services and regulatory functions for citizens and ratepayers and businesses. And my really basic common sense point is, how on earth can you assess cost-effectiveness if you don't know where exactly the costs fall now?
So is the question assessment, or is it analysis of the cost? Because surely the CCOs and council have got a fairly good handle on what those costs are.
Well, if they have, why are they not available for public scrutiny? How do the public find out where exactly the 35% of our rates which go to council-controlled organisations, where do we find that information about where these council-controlled organisations spend that money? To be fair, Auckland Transport, if you stumble across it on their website, they do give the devilish detail of awarded contracts, but that information at this point in time, to my knowledge, is not made available by any other council controlled organisation.
So the 35% of rates that go to CCOs,
yes,
pretty much all of that goes to Auckland Transport anyway, doesn't it?
Well, I don't have those exact figures before me as we speak, but my understanding is transport is definitely is a major component. But it's in terms of measuring cost effectiveness, the first thing is to find out where exactly the costs fall. The next question is this the most cost effective use of public money doing what they're currently doing? And what I've discovered, for example, is as soon as you get into contracting, you get into contract management. And what happens is that it's considered council staff too dumb to know how to do that. We need consultants. So you have this ginormous rotten iceberg where private consultants project manage the works contractors. So you've got a double layer of private sector contractocracy. Each level is out to make a buck out of the public trough because it's not being run under the public service break-even model. It's made under the profit-making model. How on earth can these services then be provided more cheaply for the public when you've got two lots of private piggies with their snout in the trough?
So you're going to the Greater Wellington Regional Council to advise them on what they should do over amalgamation. What's the message going to be?
Well, I'm attending tomorrow, Wednesday, the 11th of February. I've got 10 minutes at a Greater Wellington Regional Finance and Strategy meeting where I have requested speaking rights relating to financial reports because I've had a quick look at their financial reports, and again, there is no devilish detail of where exactly the money is being spent, and that will be the opening of the door into my raising the broader question about how sound is this Greater Wellington Regional Council proposal when there is no cost datum that establishes where the costs fall now in the Greater Wellington region. And so that will be, and what I will be requesting from the Greater Wellington Regional Council, can you please provide, under the Official Information Act, and I will table it tomorrow, the devilish detail, right now in the Greater Wellington Region, which services and regulatory functions do you perform? Who's carrying them out? Is it being done in-house, through council-controlled organisations, or in-house? And then those hard questions about the breakdown of costs with each of those services that are provided. And that's what we need in order to establish a basis for future cost effectiveness. Where's that information?
So broadly, what's the issue around the datum and the costs and the outsourcing? Surely there are ways of ensuring that that's efficiently undertaken?
And who do you think is actually checking this? Because to my knowledge, well, my experience, to be perfectly blunt, is the statutory third party public watchdogs who get paid from the public purse to look after the public interest. My experience is that most of them are spectacularly useless. In particular, in my considered opinion, the Office of the Auditor General, who's arguably got the most important role out of all of them in this respect. And what I fail to see is any of the statutory third-party watchdogs performing this function. Well, wouldn't you think that somebody would be doing it, but in the absence of anybody else doing it, well, yoo-hoo! Yeah, that's why I think that there have been serious efforts made to neck stamp me, because I am consistent and persistent, in other words, a total pain in the neck, in terms of trying to make sure that citizens and ratepayers have lawful rights to open, transparent and democratically accountable local government are met. Who else is doing it?
So why aren't you talking to the Audit New Zealand's and the other scrutinising departments of central government that handle this, rather than going to council?
Well, what I have done, I cold called the Office of the Auditor General on the 19th of December when I was in Wellington, walked in off the street, knocked on the door and said I would like to have a meeting with Bruce Robertson, who is Assistant Auditor General, and he is the top of the food chain when it comes to local government. And I got a meeting for about 20 minutes, which was very pleasant. And he knew all about my rates case. And the question that I put to him was, Bruce, I do believe that there are going to be some very hard questions asked about the role of the Office of the Auditor General, because my rates case is showing that where are the systems in place to make sure that before Auckland Council put the rates invoices and rates assessment notices into the envelopes and sent hundreds of thousands of them out to citizens and ratepayers, it appears that nobody did the very simple, basic and elementary thing of double checking that the information on these assessments and invoices complied with the lawful requirements of section 45 and 46 of the Local Government Rating Act. Now, I did my own little bit of due diligence. It took me about half an hour to get out my ruler and pencil, and beware, because when I get out my ruler and pencil, I'm going to get you. And I double checked, because under the Local Government Rating Act, section 45, rates assessment notices, it says that this is the information that must, not if you feel like it, must be on these rates assessment notices from A to P. And I looked, section A, and I look on my rates assessment form, oh yeah, that's A and that's B, and oh, we see, you know. And what I did, I found out what information was there, what information was partially there, and what was completely missing. And the thought that occurred to me was, well, good grief, if I can spend 30 minutes doing this, why on earth did nobody from Auckland Council do that? And why wasn't there great flashing disco lights as a whole point by the Office of the Auditor General to double check the system to make sure that somebody was doing that checking? Because obviously something's gone clunk, because this has not been done. And that is the basis of my new evidence, 126 pages of new evidence, which is now before the Auckland District Court in my rates case, and for which I am awaiting a reply from Auckland Council in response, to my new evidence, and I think it's going to be a little bit tricky because how are they going to magic out of the sky compliant rates assessments, notices and invoices when they've sent out hundreds of thousands of ones which are not?
Penny, thank you very much.
Auckland Transport's Lester Levy took councillors by surprise over the summer break with the announcement that they were considering light rail as an option up Queen Street. The aggrieved councillors felt that the two councillors who are appointed to Auckland Transport's board should have given everyone the heads up before Auckland Transport went public with the proposition. The councillors to the right wanted blood, and they got it at the council-controlled organisation governance meeting this month. The irate councillors worked with officers in recommending changes that would see councillors barred from board appointments. They also proposed changes to the Directors' Nomination Committee that would see nominations for directors be made by council officers only. The mayor was dead set against the proposed changes and also against having a discussion about the process out in the open. However, he couldn't muster support to block the proposed changes and send it off to a workshop. So the public got to watch an interesting discussion about the governance within the CCOs.
We looked to move to a best practice approach, and staff recommend a change to with the introduction of a nomination panel. The nomination panel would be made up of the Chief Executive, the Mayoral Chief of Staff, the CCO Chair, an IMSB member, and an independent governance professional.
Is the idea initially for that nomination panel to not include anyone from this committee except for an IMSB member in relation to saving councillor time?
Through the chair, it is about becoming a little bit more time efficient and an effective process, yes. And it is about a static group of members.
Well, I think it's an absolute for me that someone from this committee should be involved in the nomination stage.
I'm raising a red flag as a leader of this city and this council. And the red flag is for us to just breathe a little bit. Now, this is not, Madam Chair, to cast any aspersion at all upon the capabilities, administration skill or otherwise of the officers, the Chief Executive Officer or anyone else. It's purely because I just think it's that important constitutionally that we maintain the role which we had in the first term and which I don't think we should let go. Without real thought and consideration or reflection with ourselves. So, councillors, I would be asking for this matter to be deferred as a group of recommendations for a workshop and then come back here with us. Because this is about our super city structure more than anything. It's about our super city structure. And the appointment of directors is probably the most important thing we do. And once they're appointed, then they go away and do their thing. But we have to maintain, on behalf of our community, control over the direction and appointment of our directors, the diversity that we see and things like that. And the second issue of making a decision relating to whether or not we appoint people on the only CCO board that we can appoint people or not, is in my view something that we need to think about seriously. And I thought about it quite a bit last night. And my thinking is this, you can't bind a future council. If that's the intent, you can't do it. And if I'm sitting here as the mayor in the next term, or whoever's sitting here as mayor in the next term, you can't bind that person. If they want to utilise the statute to actually appoint one or two councillors to the CCO, to the Auckland Transport CCO, because as we did for the first two terms, we believed it was something important to do, then I just don't think we can pass that resolution. And I think we need to think very seriously about that resolution too. Now, what is proposed here is something that, in my view, was not in fact proposed by the legislation.
Yeah.
And I want you to think very, very seriously about this. I know one or two of you got bees under your bonnets on it, but I want you to think very seriously about what is proposed here.
You know, we've had 6 months with the chair of the Auckland Transport Panthers Committee on the 2nd of July raised issues. Haven't seen them since.
We are the governing body, and I think this committee in the past has approved the shortlisting, and we've had members on that interview panel. And I think that is, for me, a step too far to give up that to officers and independence. I think that is exactly where it must fit with this committee.
My concern, and I'll express it to you and I'll repeat again and repeat through this discussion, this is politically led. It has to be. And it's my choice to appoint who are the political leaders in this council. And I could have cemented the role by appointing myself as a political leader of this, like I did the last term. And I did not, because it's important to spread the leadership roles around the council. And that's exactly what's happened. And it is absolutely appropriate either for the mayor to be ex officio or for a member of the office to be in this panel process to ensure that there is strategic alignment. That is not the role of the chief executive officer. It is the role of the mayor.
The fact is that the public of Auckland look to the 20 councillors and the mayor to ensure the continuity between the ratepayer dollar and the CCO spending of it. That's my main continuity issue. That's not what you mean by continuity, and I know what you mean, but that is an absolutely key consideration. This is not a business. So best practice out there in business land is fine, but this is a council, and every penny that a CCO spends is a ratepayer penny. I'm sorry, I'm looking at you. I shouldn't do it. I'll put the chair. And that's, we have made good appointments. The boards are good boards. The people who've done the interviews and this particular committee have done a good job. So I've got this great phrase that says, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So I appreciate you bringing these recommendations, but there ain't nothing wrong with the way we're doing it. The people who've done it have got their own expertise. So I do not support bringing in more outsiders to manage our council.
It is at the nomination stage, or finding people to four positions, that we do have problems. And that's been a problem in the past, and I think this beats that up so that we have a more enhanced way of doing it. Because and in the past, the chief executive had a pretty important role, and we've always probably got an HR company to get involved. So I think that HR company would be the independent governance professional.
Have you ever wondered why prime farmland keeps getting built over when our district plans say it shouldn't be? I certainly have. The Unitary Plan Hearings Panel discussed this issue last month while they were hearing submissions on the rural production zone. Tonight we hear the commissioners questioning Auckland Council planning witnesses. It's interesting to watch the witness frustration as the Environment Court judge digs into the issues.
The point is that the urbanisation areas, the future development is obviously in a satellite town of Pukekohe, which has been identified for growth, and even growth out west is identified largely on elite and prime soils. Whereas if you look at Dairy Flat, for example, it's largely a white area and obviously has probably class 4 or 5 plus soils. Isn't there an inconsistency between the major and very strong policy protection for those soils and where the council's actually identified areas for urban expansion?
I really don't want to get into is it appropriate or not. All I would say is it's really important that whoever considers those expansions takes into account the trade-offs that they're making by expanding onto a prime land. That's really what I'd want to say on that, because it's not for me to say what's appropriate. You really need to direct that question to the people who are involved in that particular work stream.
Yes, I suppose as the planner and the team, obviously the soil scientist will appear later, but so you're clarifying that you weren't involved from a strategic perspective in those decisions about the identification of future growth areas?
I mean, put it in context, 10,000 hectares since I started work as a planner. My first appeals, the first 12 appeals I did were to the Tuakapara Council, where there was a soldier town over class 1 and 2 soils, and they were really concerned about it. And it's all the same arguments, in some cases the same thing. So in that intervening 40 years, there's 10,000 hectares that was gone forever. And it's not for me to say whether the decisions are right or wrong. I'm just not in that work stream. So I just think it's a really important thing to bear in mind when making those decisions.
Thank you.
A general question first, and this: to what extent do you think the plan should enable the use of land to migrate to its highest value use, as viewed from the landowner's perspective?
That's an argument, of course, I've heard many times, particularly from the valuing professionals. They tend to use the terms highest and best use, I think. I personally have a lot of difficulty with it because of what happens when you do that and the losses that you get in the unplanned development. What follows the unplanned development are the problems of reverse sensitivity and so on, demand for services. What you're suggesting is a really light-handed approach, isn't it?
And I'm not suggesting that, I'm asking you to what extent you think the plan should enable land to migrate to its highest value use, subject to managing the effects of that use, and subject to infrastructure provision, which are the two typical issues there.
Professionally, I'm a believer in as light-handed approach as you can. But I'm also aware that there are times when a light-handed approach leads you to some adverse effects. And I guess that's where I'm coming from with these, with my advice on these provisions.
It seems to me these policies go quite a considerable distance further to just managing effects.
Yes,
that is, they would suggest that certain land cannot be used in particular ways because of the nature of that land. And if I've understood it correctly, regardless of the value that would otherwise be placed on that land, in an alternative use.
Yes, that's right.
That's correct, isn't it?
Yes.
Are you suggesting that that's appropriate policy regardless of the gap between the value in say, rural production use versus an alternative use? That it simply should just be a rule?
That's a really difficult question. I think you have to decide what you want out of this. You're referring, I guess, to expansion onto really, really highly productive land, and looking at the highest and best use of that, it may well be very, very attractive, and probably is attractive, for two things. One is countryside living, and then later on for urban development. And the reasons it's attractive for that are that it's gently sloping, drains well, probably faces north, probably has quite a good roading network already, and all those things. And if you take the view that it's okay to let land go to the highest use, then what you're saying is you're putting a lower value on the inherent productive qualities of that land. Now, if we were to take a parallel between, say, the Waitakere Range, with its bush and its indigenous biodiversity, that really has some incredibly tight constraints on what you can do, particularly in the foothills, and you'll hear those arguments. In fact, there's legislation there to protect it. And I sort of regard the alien confined land in the same kind of category as rare and endangered. You know, it's something that you simply cannot replace in this location. What you've got is, you really need to talk to Dr. Karen Kinane to get the real lowdown on it. But what I take from what her research and her advice is that really we have a combination here which is pretty special. You've got frost tree, you've got good irrigation water, you've got rainfall, you've got fantastic soil, high natural productivity. To me, it just makes absolute sense to protect that for its productive value.
Yeah, and are you suggesting that should be so, regardless of the one opportunity?
Yes, I am, because you can't replace it. Simply, it's irreplaceable. And that's why I think it's really, really important. And I don't think, you know, this is, again, I'm not in the work stream, but I think if you're going to expand an urban area, why not expand it on a lesser productivity sources? It just makes sense to me. Why would you expand onto the very best soils when, in fact, you could expand onto other less productive soils? You get the best of both worlds, then, don't you?
No, indeed, which goes to Mr. Fuller's question.
Yeah.
The second the question is on a different tack, and that is in relation to rural activity. Is the constraints around rural activity take the view that only activities that relate to rural, traditional rural activity, can occur. However, a very significant issue in rural areas is creating new and diverse revenue streams and achieving economic sustainability. I'm wondering if yourself or the council has turned its mind to policies that both manage effects but allow innovation and change in terms of economic activity in the rural areas.
Good question. Yes, the answer is yes, we have. I think you, right at the beginning of your question, you said something which I didn't quite agree with, and that is that we are overly restricting
the regulations are restricted to what are called rural activities, or that they need to be located in the rural activities. So there's no opportunity, as I understand it, for new revenue stream, new businesses to emerge that have nothing to do with the rural environment. You know, just an example would be, there's a software developer who happens to want to locate in Tihana or just out of Gloucester somewhere, or anywhere like that, but it has nothing to do with the local area, but they can sustain themselves economically through this, what it would be an innovative new business. My question is, why wouldn't we want to enable that?
Thanks for watching the All About Auckland show. I hope you found the ideas interesting. To watch the show again or sign up for our newsletter, go to www.allaboutauckland.com. You can follow us on Facebook or via our Twitter handle, AboutAKL. Next week, we'll be looking at the much-awaited cost of growth study, which has just been released. See you then.